Hi students. In this video, we look at the concept of air masses, which is described in Chapter 7 on atmospheric disturbances. What is an air mass? Air masses are large, variable parcels of air. They have to be distinguished from the surrounding air, and they are quite large, approximately 1,000 miles across, and they can be several kilometers deep. Their properties are uniform, so their temperature, their humidity, and their stability should be generally homogeneous. They must travel as a unit, and as I said, they are distinct from the surrounding air. So, as an example here, you see the CP air mass, which stands for continental and polar. This is where the air mass originates, over a continent and in the polar region. And what would you expect from continental polar air? Continental air, as opposed to an air mass that originates over an ocean, is going to be dry. And in terms of temperature, polar obviously is going to be a colder air mass. So you see how the, and it's going to be somewhat stable as well, how the temperature, humidity, and stability are similar all along the air mass. The place where air masses originate is important. Air masses have specific source regions that are well suited to generate those particular air masses. So again, with the continental polar example, it originates over land, it's continental, it originates from the poles, and this air mass may travel, but the place where it originates is in the Arctic. So air masses are going to have a lowercase c or a lowercase m before them. M stands for maritime, so it's going to be an air mass that originates over an ocean. Lowercase c stands for continental, originating over a land mass. The second letter in the air mass designation indicates the latitude. So is it going to be a tropical location, a polar location? The capital P for polar, obviously, and the capital T for tropical. So you'll notice here some differences. All of these polar masses are cold, but the maritime will be wet and cold. The continental polar will be dry and cold, whereas the maritime tropical air masses will be warm and wet. The continental tropical will be hot and dry as it originates over the continent. And air masses in the places that they travel to are going to affect the humidity, they're going to affect the temperature, and they're going to, importantly, affect the stability. So if you can imagine when a continental tropical air mass, particularly the warm and wet air mass, comes in contact with the continental polar air mass, the opposing air masses, you're going to have most likely a warm front, most likely a cold front, and it should generate some instability. How do we classify the air masses? So I just talked about that a little bit, how we use the letter system, lowercase c and lowercase m, and then the second letter indicates the temperature. So you might have an uppercase E for equatorial, a T for tropical, a P for polar, and then A for Arctic or Antarctic. So the equatorial, obviously, are going to be in the low latitudes, tropical from between 10 and 35 degrees north and south. This is the idealized model here of the source regions of air masses, but we don't actually have a continent that looks exactly like this. If we did, we could expect that this would be the way the source regions would play out. From 55 degrees to 70 degrees north and south are considered polar. and from 70 degrees north and south up into the north and south poles will be Arctic and Antarctic. Notice that the middle latitudes are not a major source region. So in the United States, for most of the United States, where we're between 30 and 60 degrees north and south, you will see variable weather because it's the location where major air masses meet, not where they originate. Sorry, I know there's a lot on this slide. If you want to, I'm not going to go over the text too much, but if you want to take notes on it, then I recommend that you go to the online lecture for Chapter 7. These are the same slides that you find there. All right, so how is an air mass, when it moves from its source region into another area, how is it going to modify the temperature? I gave the example of a continental polar air blast. Sometimes you hear about an Arctic blast, and that's what this is referring to. Obviously, what happens to the temperature as this air mass advances to the south? You see a drop in temperature with a corresponding drop in humidity. And so even down here, look at negative 4 degrees Celsius, even all the way down here in Houston. So significant impact on the temperatures there. And we've already talked about where these different air masses originate, but to point out something significant here for us in the United States, particularly on the East Coast, you have this maritime tropical air mass coming into contact with this continental polar air mass. So cold and dry air colliding with warm and wet air. This maritime tropical air mass, as it moves in, is going to propel a lot of the weather that we see here. A lot of it's the principal precipitation source, actually, east of the Rockies. And for southern Canada and for much of Mexico. So in this area here, you'll want to remember that the maritime tropical air mass is the principal precipitation source. Continental is not as important as the others. The continental tropical, I should say, is not as important as the other air masses in North America, but it will impact those monsoons as they in the summer months in the southwest. The Arctic and the continental polar, as we saw in this example, are going to dominate in the winter, so this will bring the cooler temperatures during that time of year. Okay, then the next slide we will cover fronts. So in this video we've just looked at the source regions and the different kinds of air masses, but this is very important for an understanding of fronts and how they will relate to atmospheric disturbances.